Hello and welcome to another slice of Daily Bread. I'm so glad that you have joined us today. Today's devotional will be brought to us by Dr. Tim Riesenberger. He's an emergency doctor. Dr. Tim, welcome to Daily Bread.
Thanks, Lowell.
Now, as we always do before we begin, let's open with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. We thank you for your blessings. We pray and thank you for your word, and just pray that as we open your word, as we take a look at it today, that your spirit will bless us and guide us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. The blind would see, the deaf would hear, the dead were raised to life. Certainly, the life of Christ was very full of miracles, things that were defying our senses, that defied logic, that defied even natural law. But how many of you have actually seen a miracle nowadays? Have you ever wondered to yourself, God, don't you care? Don't you want to work in my life today? My mom is dying of cancer. Isn't there anything anyone can do? Oh no, our three-year-old just died in a tragic accident. Does God care? Does God still work miracles today? Well, I just want to encourage you, He does. I was on a mission trip to Kenya, and I was doing a medical clinic at a small remote village. There were tons of conditions. Most of them were common infectious diseases, a few lifestyle diseases, but one of particular interest came from an 80-year-old woman. Her name was Barita. She was being led very slowly by one of her relatives because she couldn't see. She went to sit down, almost missed the bench, but thankfully we slid a seat under her at the last minute. I introduced myself. Hi, I'm Dr. Tim Riesenberger. What seems to be the trouble? Well, I can't see. I kind of rolled my eyes and I'm like, well, what are we really going to do for this elderly woman? I said, since when couldn't you see? I brightened up a little bit when she said last month. I said, oh, did you fall? No. Did you get anything in your eyes? No. Did you have any pain? No. I said, what did you notice around a month ago? She said, I noticed that my heart was just pounding. I felt that my heartbeat was very irregular. That has been going on for about 2 months. I checked her pulse, did a cardiac exam, and diagnosed atrial fibrillation. Ah, it pieced together for me then. Atrial fibrillation has a very low risk, but definite consideration for stroke. So most likely she had several strokes to the back part of her brain, which is in control of her vision. Unfortunately, unless we see you within about 3 hours for a stroke, there's not much we can do. Occasionally, even up to 12 or 24 hours, there may be a chance to partially restore function. But after a month, there's no way anyone could do anything. There are a few other conditions of blindness that are reversible. Of course, cataracts could be removed. I did an eye exam on her. No cataracts. She couldn't perceive counting fingers or even perceiving light. She had no accommodation in her vision. She wasn't able to track anything. She was basically a zero for the optical exam. As far as other conditions, perhaps retinal detachment is a consideration. That's when the back of your eye tears away from its blood supply. But you have only a few hours for that as well. At the most, maybe a day. There is a condition called temporal arteritis, where the arteries inflame that supply your eyes with nutrition. However, once you're blind from that condition, you're blind. There's nothing you can do to reverse the vision loss. The only thing you can do is try to salvage the other eye. But unfortunately, she was blind in both. And so I told her, as I always tell everyone, we are going to do the best that we can to help you, but God is the great physician. I laid my hand on her shoulder and I prayed the prayer that I always pray for my patients. Loving Father in heaven, we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, the great physician, if it is for your glory and honor and according to your will and for Barita's greatest good, we ask that she would be able to see again. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. I then began to explain to her the condition that she had, that atrial fibrillation creates a risk for throwing clots to your brain and other parts of your body, that we were going to give her some anticoagulant medication to prevent further strokes. Of course, we couldn't do anything about the stroke now. We were also going to refer her to a neurologist. As I was explaining the plan of action to her, she interrupted me and said something to my translator. "But I can see now." And I said, "What? But I'm seeing now." I couldn't believe my ears. I had never seen anything like this in my life, up to this point or even afterwards. I thought at first she must be mistaken. And so I repeated the eye exam. Not only could she see, all the parameters were normal. She could count fingers, perceive light, track, and accommodate. When I did the cardiac exam, the atrial fibrillation was gone. I couldn't believe it. In unexpected joy and disbelief, I grabbed something nearby. It was a little picture on a pill bottle, vitamins. And I said, "Here, read this label." She said, "I can't read." I said, "No, we'll get something in your language." "I can't read my language." I said, "Well, just tell me what is on this label." She said, "It's a bowl of fruit." "Identify the fruits. An apple, an orange, a banana. What color are they?" "Red, yellow, and orange." She could see. At this point, the other patients that were waiting in line had caught wind of what was going on, and they started shouting and singing. Everyone just went crazy. Everyone and their brother came out of the woodwork to our clinic. And finally, I said, "Listen, there's too many of you. We're not going to be able to see you all." They said, "You don't have to see us, just touch us." I told my nurse, I said, "Listen, can you control everybody and calm them down?" She said, "Well, first, can you pray for my knee? No one's been able to do anything about that." And I said, "You're not helping." So we, of course, tried to calm everyone down, but it was very difficult, as you could imagine. Finally, the elderly woman, Barita, stood up to walk away. I said, "Wait, where are you going?" She said, "I'm going home." I said, "Well, why?" She's like, "I can see now." I said, "No, I want to talk to your family." And I'm ashamed to say I insisted on talking to her family, just like the Pharisees in John chapter 9. They wouldn't believe this miracle. In John 9, 24 and 25, "Then again called they the man that was blind and said unto him, Give God the praise. We know that this man is a sinner." In this case, I know I'm a sinner. Tim Riesenberger, chief of sinners, but forgiven. But in the case of John 9, Jesus was not a sinner. "And so the blind man answered and said, Whether he be a sinner or no, I know not. One thing I know, that whereas I was blind, now I see." We have a picture. You can take a look at Barita. In the picture, it's very amazing because I am ecstatic in disbelief. Even my nurse is shocked. But the expression on her face is almost like, "Why are you taking a picture of me?" This is how my God works. She has tremendous faith when the rest of us are amazed in unbelief. I can tell you that day was an eventful day, not just for me, not just for Barita, but for all of us. But something strange entered my mind. You know, after her event and the miracle, I began praying for every patient even before I talked to them, not at the end, but at the beginning. I had one man that couldn't walk, and he said, "Listen, can you help me with my legs?" I said, I'll pray for you right now. And he said, "Wait, let me tell you the rest of the story." I said, "I don't need to know. Let's pray." When I prayed with him, I asked him, "See if you can walk." But he did not walk. And neither was any patient after that healed miraculously. And so when I went home that evening, I thought, well, why? Isn't that what we all would wonder about? God, don't you want to heal them all? Don't you care about all your children? And of course we know that God does. We know in the case of the Pool of Bethesda in John chapter 5, we're told that Jesus Christ longed to heal them all, to exercise his healing power to heal them all, but it was the Sabbath day. So he chose the very worst case to heal. But I thought to myself, why don't we see miracles now? Isn't God the same now as he was then? Then God shared with me an amazing insight. The next day, as you can imagine, everybody showed up at clinic. In fact, it was so many individuals that we needed several nurses to triage them all. However, about halfway through the day, I saw something that made me cry. One of the nurses was holding a bag of money. And I said, "What do you have there?" She hid it quickly behind her back. I insisted on knowing. And as she pulled out a bag of money, the pieces fell into place in my mind. I now understood why God cannot work. You see, this nurse had been charging every patient to be seen. Not a lot of money, but still some nonetheless. I insisted that she return every amount of money to every patient we had seen. She said, "But those organizing the clinic told us." I said, "I don't care if the president of our denomination called you and said that. I am providing this service for free. I am providing the medicines for free, and I will not see one more patient until you return every last penny to these patients." Surprisingly, in 5 minutes, they had all the money returned. But I also had an insight. Of course, I saw all the patients that day. I was thankful they got the money back. But I now was enlightened. You see, my eyes were opened as to why God cannot work in this way now. We would take the gifts of the Holy Spirit and we would use them for our selfish gain. That night, as I prayed, agonizing with God, He led me to a passage in the 6th volume of the Testimonies. "The Lord does not now work to bring many souls into the truth." What? Did you hear that correctly? The Lord does not work to bring any souls into the truth? I thought that's what our job was, to bring people into the truth. But here's the passage. It says, "The Lord does not now work to bring many souls into the truth because of the church members who have never been converted and those who were once converted but who have backslidden. What influence would these unconsecrated members have on new converts? Would they not make of no effect the God-given message which His people are to bear?" That's 6 Testimonies, page 370. You see, the greatest witness for Christianity is Christians. But the worst witness for Christianity is also Christians. That is, professed Christians. And I can tell you that I'm no different. I have to tell you with shame that I had the least amount of faith in this whole scenario. I insisted on examining Barita over and over again. I insisted that she stay there until I called her family. I actually did call her family. One of them arrived, and I didn't allow them to talk to Barita. I ran over to them before they could communicate to her or her other family members, and I said, "Why did you bring your grandmother here?" They said, "Well, she was blind." I said, "For how long? Since when?" "For 1 month." Every piece of the story was corroborated. And then I looked over at Barita, and she got up and walked away with no assistance. You see, her faith was great. I believe that God healed her in spite of our unbelief, in spite of the fact that we would misappropriate the gift of the Holy Spirit. He knew that His daughter needed that gift. And so my assurance to you is that if you have faith, God will hear your prayer. If you are sincere, if you believe His word, He will help you. However, God does not now work because of us, the ones in the truth that have backslidden from it. But some people will ask, what is the context of that quote? Exactly what message are we missing? Exactly what message have we backslidden from? The context says, there is a message regarding health reform to be born in every church. There is a work to be done in every school. Neither principal nor teachers should be entrusted with the education of the youth until they have a practical knowledge of the subject. Some have felt at liberty to criticize and question and find fault with health reform principles of which they knew little by experience. They should stand shoulder to shoulder, heart to heart with those who are working in right lines. The subject of health reform has been presented in the churches, but the light has not been heartily received. Isn't that something you notice? What I've seen in the last few years is that the world is more interested in health sometimes than even we are. They're like raw, they're vegan, they're macrobiotic. They know stuff that even I don't know. Whereas we are lagging far behind. That is my appeal to all of us as a people. Let us believe our own message. Let us live it. The quote continues on. The subject of health reform has been presented in the churches, but the light has not been heartily received. The selfish, health-destroying indulgences of men and women have counteracted the influence of the message that is to prepare a people for the great day of God. If the churches expect strength, they must live the truth which God gives them. If the members of our churches disregard the light on this subject, they will reap the sure result in both spiritual and physical degeneracy. And the influence of these older church members will leaven those newly come to the faith. And then the quote begins, "The Lord does not now work to bring many souls." That's the context, brothers and sisters. And so if you want to see God work in your life, I do, I know, then believe what He's given you. Follow the light by His grace. Christ will give you help. And if you are like me and you struggle with unbelief, God will help anyway. God will give you grace and strength. I am ashamed to say I didn't believe Berita. In fact, even now to this day, I have colleagues at my workplace who say, "You didn't examine her right. You must have been deceived. She must have been lying to you." But then I thought to myself, no, how could I perform the cardiac and the optical exam wrong? Can somebody fake being blind? Well, I suppose they could, but certainly you can't fake having atrial fibrillation. You can't turn it on and off. And I can tell you, it is very rare to see these miracles. I'll be honest with you, I haven't seen anything before that or since that, and it was about a year ago today. But I know that God still works miracles. But the greatest miracle He can work is converting our hearts. Won't you let Him into your heart today? I want to. Let's pray. Loving Father in heaven, thank you so much for Berita, for her miracle, for her faith in the face of my unbelief. Thank you, Lord, for showing me that you still work miracles today and that you want to work miracles. But what prevents you is our unbelief. Lord, I pray that we as a people would embrace not only the health message, but the three angels' message, all of our light that you've so generously bestowed on us, Lord, and that we would live it ourselves and share it with those in darkness. Lord, I pray that you would be with Berita, wherever she may be. Lord, as her eyes have been opened physically, may her eyes always be open spiritually. And I pray that her faith would burn brightly in all of our hearts, encouraging us and letting us know and reminding us that you are God and that there is no other, and that you are the same loving, compassionate, miracle-working God today as you were back then. We love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.